From the sleek lineage of the F-16 Fighting Falcon came a visionary leap in aerospace design, the F-16XLL. Conceived in the late 1970s by the same General Dynamics team, this prototype featured a striking, massive cranked aero delta wing that delivered unparalleled agility and performance. The wing's innovative design provided a 25% higher lift-to-drag ratio in supersonic flight and a whopping 120% larger surface area compared to the standard Fighting Falcon. Constructed with cutting-edge carbon composite materials, it saved 600 pounds of weight while boosting structural strength and aerodynamic efficiency. The F-16XL could even carry twice the payload and travel 44% farther without external fuel tanks. But despite being arguably one of America's greatest fighters ever developed, in the world of aircraft design and production, better doesn't always mean more convenient. The story of the General Dynamics F-16XL began with the F-16 Fighting Falcon, an American single-engine supersonic multi-role fighter aircraft with a cropped delta wing design. Originating from the United States Air Force's lightweight fighter program in the early 1970s, the model entered service in 1978 and quickly gained a reputation for its versatility and combat effectiveness. Fresh off winning the competition, David Lewis, the company's chairman and chief executive officer, was already looking ahead and set his company's designers to work on developing derivatives of the F-16. One of these ventures sought to explore the possibility of supercruise, the ability to travel at supersonic speeds without using afterburners. While this feature is standard on fifth-generation jets in the 1970s, supercruise was still a pipe dream. At that time, achieving supersonic speeds required activating the afterburners, which utilize a jet engine's unspent oxygen, as most engines only use about half by mixing it with jet fuel. This mixture is injected into the engine's exhaust stream and then ignited to create a blowtorch effect. And while the process significantly boosts thrust, increasing engine power by 40 to 70% in modern fighters, afterburners have a glaring downside: excessive fuel consumption. A Fighting Falcon consumes 50,000 pounds of fuel per hour with its afterburners engaged. With only 7,000 pounds on board, the aircraft operating on afterburners would burn through its entire reserve in less than 10 minutes. And so, in order to achieve the benefits of supersonic flight without the fuel inefficiency of afterburners, General Dynamics designers set about creating a modified model capable of supercruise. In 1977, General Dynamics initiated the Supersonic Cruise and Maneuver Prototype Project, or SCAMP. The main goal was not to sell an aircraft to the Pentagon, replace or upgrade the then brand new F-16. Instead, it served as a scientific experiment to push the F-16's performance boundaries and take the first steps toward developing supercruise technology. The project was established to examine whether a cranked aero delta wing, with more than twice the surface area of a standard F-16 wing, could provide low drag at supersonic speeds without compromising maneuverability at low speeds. Following an agreement with the USAF in late 1980, General Dynamics procured two full-scale development F-16S, while the service provided another two for modification. Harry J. Hilliker, an engineer involved in aircraft design since 1942 and the principal designer of the original Fighting Falcon, was also chosen to lead this new effort. General Dynamics invested heavily in researching and developing the new prototype, partnering with NASA to test more than 150 configurations, including 3,600 hours in the agency's tunnels. The result was the F-16XL, a modified Fighting Falcon with a radically different wing configuration. Interestingly, the XL designation did not stand for extra large. In fact, it was coined by Harry Hilliker during a round of golf, when he noticed he was using top-flight XL golf balls and decided it was the perfect name for a craft intended to fly further than the original F-16. Still, it was a fitting nickname. The SCAMP program eventually transformed into the F-16XL project, involving a team of more than 600 specialists who contributed to its innovative design and development. Beyond supercruise technology, the F-16XL significantly departed from the original F-16 Fighting Falcon. The aircraft was larger at 54 feet 2 inches long and 17 feet 7 inches high, with an empty weight of 22,000 pounds and a maximum takeoff weight of 48,000 pounds. There were two prototypes, the single-seat F-16 XL-1 and the twin-seat F-16 XL-2. Their fuselages were lengthened by 56 inches through the addition of a 26-inch rear section and a 30-inch front extension. This modification allowed the tail to tilt up 3 degrees, preventing the engine nozzle from hitting the runway during takeoff and landing. The pièce de résistance of this prototype was its cranked aero delta wing. With a wingspan of 34 feet and a surface area of 633 square feet, 120% larger than the standard F-16 wing, the wing was constructed from carbon composite materials, saving 600 pounds of weight from the already heavy model. The wing's swept angles ranged from 50 to 70 degrees, which contributed to improved aerodynamic efficiency. This innovative wing design provided a higher lift-to-drag ratio, enhancing both subsonic and supersonic flight performance. The aircraft could carry a significantly larger payload, with 27 hardpoints compared to the F-16's 9. This allowed it to be potentially armed with a variety of weapons, including a 20mm N61A1 Vulcan cannon, AIM-9 Sidewinder infrared homing air-to-air missiles, and up to 15,000 pounds of external ordnance. For air-to-air combat, the F-16 XL could be equipped with 4 advanced medium-range air-to-air missiles along with 2 Sidewinders. This extensive armament capacity made the F-16 XL a versatile and powerful multi-role fighter, capable of performing various missions from air superiority to ground attack. Following an extensive developmental phase, the first model ready to soar was the single-seat F-16 XL-1. On July 3, 1982, one of the most elegant American fighters ever built lifted off from Carswell Air Force Base, near the Fort Worth Division of General Dynamics, where both experimental prototypes had been meticulously constructed, flown by pilot James McKinney at the controls. The second variant, the twin-seat F-16 XL-2, powered by the 110G-129 engine, made its maiden flight on October 29, 1982, with Alex Wolf and Jim McKinney at the helm. This particular aircraft emerged from the remains of a third F-16 XL, which had suffered severe damage in August 1980, when a nose tire malfunction during takeoff led to a crash on the lake bed, causing extensive damage and requiring complete reconstruction. Subsequent Air Force flight test evaluations of the F-16 XL program took place at the Flight Test Center at Edwards Air Force Base from 1982 to 1983. The F-16 XL exhibited remarkable capabilities during these tests, outperforming the standard Fighting Falcon in several key areas. The model could carry twice the payload and fly an outstanding 44% farther without external fuel tanks. Meanwhile, its improved aerodynamic design gave it a 25% higher lift-to-drag ratio during supersonic flight and an 11% improvement in subsonic flight. The F-16 XL could fly 83 knots faster at sea level using full military power and 311 knots faster at altitude on an afterburner while carrying a bomb load. It demonstrated superior stability and control during high-speed maneuvers with excellent spin resistance and out-of-control recovery. Two additional capabilities of the F-16 XL that contributed to survivability were, according to a magazine article from the era, quote, first is improved instantaneous maneuverability coupled with greatly expanded flight operating limits. And second is reduced radar signature resulting from the configuration shaping. With the F-16 XL program hitting and surpassing milestones left and right, more than one service was taking notice. In the early 1980s, reports of the F-16 XL's impressive performance spread worldwide. While initially not intended for mass production, the aircraft's capabilities got some attention, with many recognizing its potential beyond supercruise experiments. According to a magazine article from the time, the F-16 XL was being considered by the Japanese Air Self-Defense Force as a replacement for its current ground attack aircraft. Its extended range, payload capacity, and suitability for both ground attack and air-to-air roles also made it an attractive option for United States maritime defense operations as well. However, the most significant potential client was the United States Air Force itself. In 1981, the service announced the Enhanced Tactical Fighter Program to find a replacement for the F-111 Aardvark multi-role combat aircraft, requiring a model capable of deep interdiction missions without support. As such, General Dynamics entered the F-16 XL into the competition against a modified version of McDonnell Douglas F-15B Eagle. The decision-making process involved extensive testing and evaluation of both aircraft. The USAF was looking for an aircraft that could meet specific performance criteria, including payload capacity, range, survivability, and overall mission effectiveness. The F-16 XL impressed military top brass with its ability to carry double the payload of the standard F-16 and travel 40% further due to increased fuel capacity. It also demonstrated superior stability and maneuverability, which were crucial for the deep interdiction missions envisioned by the ETF program. Still, the USAF selected the F-15B Eagle, later known as the F-15 E-Strike Eagle, in February 1984. Unlike the radically modified F-16 XL, the winner, essentially a modified F-15 two-seat trainer, required fewer structural changes to the already in production Eagle, making transitioning to full-scale production of the ETF winner simpler and more cost-effective. Additionally, the model's twin-engine design also offered higher survivability in combat, as it could continue flying if one engine was disabled, unlike the single-engined XL with a radically different wing. John G. Williams, the chief engineer of the F-16 XL, later remarked that the USAF's decision to choose the F-15B was more political than practical. Quote, "The XL is a marvelous airplane, but was a victim of the USAF wanting to continue to produce the F-15, which is understandable. Sometimes you win these political games, sometimes not. In most ways, the XL was superior to the F-15 as a ground attack airplane, but the F-15 was good enough." Limited F-16 XL flight testing continued until October 1985, by which time it had accumulated nearly 800 sorties before the prototypes were placed in storage. However, the story didn't end there. In 1988, the two F-16 XL prototypes were transferred to NASA Ames-Dryden Flight Research Facility for Supersonic Laminar Flow Control, SLFC, research as part of the High-Speed Civil Transport, HSCT, program. This aimed to develop technologies for future commercial supersonic aircraft. During the 1990s, NASA continued to use these aircraft in its high-speed research, HSR, program, focusing on various aspects of commercial supersonic flight. The unique wing configuration of the F-16 XL made it ideal for these studies, leading to extensive aerodynamic testing to improve wing airflow during sustained supersonic flight. Reassigned as 848 and 849, these aircraft played a crucial role in testing aerodynamic innovations. In 1995, F-16 XL 849 embarked on a notable mission, flying just 200 feet behind a NASA SR-71. The goal: to study the SR-71 supersonic shockwave in real time. During these flights, sophisticated instruments captured detailed data on the shockwave's shape and intensity. This information was vital for NASA engineers as they worked to reduce the impact of sonic booms over populated regions. In the mid-1990s, the same two-seat F-16 XL underwent extensive modifications for the supersonic boundary layer control research project. A turbine-driven suction system was installed in the fuselage, and a modified thicker left wing pulled in boundary layer air to maintain laminar airflow over the wing. Further, when one of the models had an engine upgrade to the much more powerful General Electric F-110-129, it achieved limited supercruise. The original design goal of the F-16 XL, reaching Mach 1.1 at 20,000 feet on full military power. In 2007, NASA reached out to Lockheed Martin, which had taken over General Dynamics, to explore the idea of reviving one of the prototypes for flight. Despite these discussions, by the program's conclusion in 2008, both aircraft were retired and placed back into storage. Meanwhile, the F-16 Fighting Falcon, which first took to the skies nearly 50 years ago, continues to serve actively with the USAF, Air Force Reserve Command, and Air National Guard units. Its reliability and performance have led to its adoption by over 24 countries worldwide. Although the F-16XL never achieved operational service, it significantly advanced the concept of supercruise. While it did not attain true supercruise without afterburners, the research informed future aircraft designs, including the F-22 Raptor. The F-16XL, with its cranked aero delta wing and exceptional performance, remains one of the most remarkable fighter aircraft ever developed.